We live on location. This is the Kato and the TMOTT crew morning show. And we live up here at Thump Studio. Charlie Fenwick's Blicky.
Sure.
Checking on the mics. And we up here with the good JY, Junkyard. What's up, T? All right. And so we're gonna run around the questions to Junkyard. I mean, last time we interviewed Junkyard, if y'all remember, was up in that hotel right before the reunion.
Yeah.
In New Carrollton.
Yep.
Yeah. So, and that's been a couple of years.
Yeah.
That was a couple years ago.
Huh?
Yep.
Yeah. We were all up in that room. Okay, so we got, I guess, a list of runner questions. We got Miss Maiah, who works with the morning show, who also works with y'all out. We know Nena the Bean, we call her. Nena the Bean, cause her head shaped like a bean.
I got you.
I know that. Learn something new every day.
And also Preston, Big Press right here.
Yeah, what's up?
So
BagweRecord.com.
Right. So first of all, and we'll get into that a little later, but I wanna start off with congratulating Junkyard for the award that you won at the Go-Go Awards.
Thank you, which
was no doubt, you know, way past due, you know. And many more is due. And once we all get together as a Go-Go community and do our job ourselves, where we know it can be done like it's supposed to be done, it'd be even better.
They ain't nominate me.
Yeah, we know that. We talked to them.
That was a crime. That was a crime
that they did not nominate Wink. And the only thing I can say in their defense is,
they don't know no better.
You can't do what you don't know, right. You know. And they even apologized for that, and say next time they gonna do what they didn't do. Excuse me, which was come to the Go-Go community to get the information they need. You know, research basically. Well, from what they told the Post, yeah, but we.
I think 95 and 93 should come together and get it worldwide, you know, all the way to Mars.
but you know, as wild as I think that may not happen, that would be vicious if it was, because what it would also do is bring the two stations together, because they got their own little beef thing going, you know what I'm saying? And I think bringing the two stations together will bring the city together even more powerful. But, you know, it ain't like one fighting for the other. They all, you know, one is fighting for the other, which in the long run hurts us. You know, one can get mad at you because you did something with the other, you know, so. Yeah, okay. All right, we'll start the first question, and we'll just put it on the floor. KC, everybody was talking about, well, this takes it to the awards, I guess. Everybody was talking about when you leaped on the speaker, nobody seen you use your hands, and was kind of wondering what kind of pill you took to make you leap that high.
Spidey pill.
Dude, that was some Mexican jumping beans. Nah, that's from my athletic ability, you know what I mean? Coming up in my days, my sports. Okay. Still got my ups. Yeah, anybody want to try me on that court? Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay, because somebody said it was from leaping fences. And
got something to do with that, running from the police.
Nah. Dogs.
Dogs, too. Your name was Stray Cats.
So... How long has Junkyard been in existence? I want to get that clear because I know we did an anniversary 1 or 2 years ago. So Baker got the mic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Junk was first started in 1980 off the buckets and cans.
26 years.
And it's like four of us now still original. It's in the back.
Okay.
You remember your first show?
Savoy. Down Savoy.
When you said Savoy?
Yeah, Savoy Elementary. We charged 10 cents to get in.
Did y'all pack it?
Did we? Every little kid, they cousins was in that joint. Snotty nose, butted up drawers, and everything was in that joint.
Wink, I'm like, Wink, since Wink got the mic, and we talking 26 years, so I know there's many, but see if you can name one of your most memorable shows that always go down at the top of your memory is.
Gotta be one of them Oak Crest Recreation Center shows, but Air Raid.
Okay. Okay. Oh, yeah. That's what
Oak Crest
was. So was Air Raid like a big influence on
you?
I mean, like, what was some of y'all major influences?
It was mostly Trouble, Air Raid. Mass Extinction, too. Because Trouble, y'all, like, helped us build us with our showmanship, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Air Raid, you know what I'm saying? We say they gave us our little drive. And we put our own Southeast hump to it. Mm-hmm. And it was like, everywhere they was at, they took us with them. You know what I'm saying? All them Boondock Marlins and all that. Cross Creek.
Yeah.
Way out there, all them places.
Back that up. Suge took us to the drive, because that was Will. He's looking up Suge.
Nah, I'm talking about the band. He talking about the band.
Yeah, as far as band.
Individual Chuck. Member. I say every.
Chuck. Now, I can tell you, first time I seen y'all, it was with Mass Extinction. Yeah, it was with, and I had mentioned that before, it was when, like I said, it's hard to remember, it may have been Northwest Guys, but I remember Mass was playing, now I'm kind of shaky, it was either Mass or Trouble, but they took a break, and y'all played during the break, and that was my first time, and y'all played maybe a good 15, 20 minutes, I believe. I know that was some years ago. You know what I'm saying? But I also remember, yeah, if y'all remember the Showmobile.
Yeah.
With Raymond Gray, you know. Mr. Gray.
Department of Recreation.
Yeah. The summer jobs. That was, you know, those were our Mary and Barry summer jobs.
Put your phone on back, Raider. Right.
He was the short white guy. He was the
keep that.
Raymond Gray had gray hair. I know the office, the Department of Recreation office, was up on Park Road, and because that's where we used to have to go pick up our checks. We used to pick out some of youth employment checks on Wednesdays up there. Thank you, Mary Burr, exactly.
Used to have us training the kids to show them how to put the bands together. What was his name? With the ponies.
At the old Ronald McDonald house.
Oh.
Go up there.
I know you talking about.
Nope. Awesome Mr. Drive.
Yeah.
He was up there doing that time.
Okay.
Moving on to, like, when y'all signed with Def Jam, how did it come about? Did Def Jam search y'all out, or did y'all submit something to Def Jam?
We was playing down 19th and M one day. We played early Friday with the Buckets of Cash. And a guy named Perry came and hooked us up with Def Jam. Because he had a lot of connects and stuff with New York Perry anyway. So
right.
He hooked us up with Def Jam. And we got on from there.
Okay. How was that experience? What movie was that? Was it Tougher Than Lover?
Oh, it was an exciting experience. Because, you know, that was our first. We already felt like we was rich already.
Right. Okay.
Man, we felt real happy, man. Some of that stuff we had to get out of school, we was happy at that.
Okay.
because one of the interesting things, but I'm always debating with New Yorkers about hip hop, because they look at Def Jam as being the mecca of rap, like, you know, rap stuff jumped off with Def Jam. But then I remind them that one of the first artists signed was Junkyard, which was a go-go band. So even then they recognize go-go music, but I guess he just didn't go further. He just got diverted with the rap music. But that always leaves them like stumped that something they love is built on go-go music.
From the information I researched, Junkyard and LL along with Beastie Boys was all signed at the same time.
Right, signed at the same time.
Right, so what I'm saying is, their single was like...
Yeah, we was all around at one table.
All of them was out at the same time. I think that maybe Def Jam promoters pushed more of the hip-hop, more of the LL, and more of the Beastie Boys.
Right.
But I think they just put a little bit more effort to promote those groups more so than promote the go-go. I don't know why they took to the hip-hop and why they didn't pick up on the go-go. But
I
think
they were based in New York.
Correct.
Right.
You know,
correct.
That's probably what it was. And they knew hip-hop, but they didn't know go-go.
Correct. Because hip-hop was underground.
Right.
Right.
Exactly.
Okay. Then moving on to DC Cab. And then moving on up to Cavalier. Yeah, that's it. With tougher than ever. Huh? The kazoos. What's up with the kazoos? Oh, yeah, it sure was, wasn't it?
Not yet, Johnny.
Okay. Okay. Now we're moving on to we approaching the late 80s. Right? Okay. Approaching the late 80s, where Junkyard is his come more than just a, you know, a little novelty joint, but they really starting to make noise because they bringing in a new generation. And I think I had mentioned before where Junkyard, I always considered Junkyard the leaders of the new school, because when the style of go-go started changing when the 90s rolled in, it was Junkyard who led that change in there. So any comment, I guess, regarding that? And then I guess we talking about, yeah. That was what, late 80s, early 90s, right?
Yeah, like from 87 on up until the 90s.
Okay. And then basically, what kind of change were y'all noticing during that time, would you say?
We all was growing up real fast, you know what I'm saying? That we seen that we was just as powerful as the mainstream bands that was already in sync with the go-go.
Right.
Already, Red Asses, Trouble, Chuck, all that. We was just as powerful as them on Jump.
Right.
But we felt though we was getting too old to keep playing on that Jump. So we asked Mo, you know what I'm saying, step us up. We want to get some real equipment.
Right, that's why the next question was, what was it that made you decide, okay, now it's time to go into real equipment?
That was us and Heavy One's word, you know what I'm saying? Heavy One pushed that to, he more so brought it to everybody's attention that we was getting too old to be playing on that Jump. So Heavy One, you know what I'm saying, got in everybody's ear, and everybody went to Mo.
Right.
And one thing led to another. Next, you know, that one good particular Monday of Troubles, man, he just came out of the blue with all that stuff, man. Everybody felt like kids all over again. We just pressed to set the stuff up and all that. We had
a bonus too.
Yeah. We got some money that day and everything. it was Christmas. It was after Christmas. It was right after Christmas. The New Year was ready to come up.
Mm-hmm.
I think we played up Tribbles that Monday before Christmas Eve came.
Yeah.
So that right after that Christmas, that following Monday, he gave us a $500 check and pulled all that stuff out the van.
What year would you say that would be?
That was 87.
87, okay.
I remember that vaguely.
It's half coming together.
It was the same color as those cargoes right there. Man, okay. I tried to break my hands on them children.
It all started 1979. Two groups of nappy head, dirty little youngins down in Projects, Berry Farms, Southeast Washington, D.C. One group led by none other than himself, the heavy one. Another group led by Bugs. Both groups playing on boxes, buckets, and cans. Didn't know what they were doing, just having some fun.
Wow. Get a hum, my big daddy.
In 1980 came Derek McRae. He brought together the two groups, Heavy One's group and Bug's group. He made one group. They called it Junkyard Band. They called him Big Daddy. They took the band out on the streets of D.C., performing all around. Became a tourist attraction. Became a commercial attraction. Playing on boxes, buckets, and cans on the streets of D.C.
Here's a story about the Junkyard Band that started 4 years ago. We were playing in the alley, cause it's Southeast Berry Farm, Southeast Berry Farm. The Junkyard Band started moving up, the hard work paid off. Laughing and playing with the manager, Mr. Dirk McRae, Mr. Dirk McRae. The public started loving it, we were finally getting our props. We're now saying in DC camp, also Cavaliers, also Cavaliers. We'll go, go, Bugs. That's me, y'all, folks, the wink. Now Tricky Reds make a hit. Footloose Rock, Little Dirk and Reese, Mike and Huss, and here's the Junkyard Band. Here we go.
From playing the streets of D.C., the band gained a lot of notoriety. All the big companies started calling. Pepsi, Coke, McDonald's, Cavaliers, Roy Rogers, so forth and so on. In 1984, we took the band on the road to New York and other cities.
Tonight, from our nation's capital, Washington, D.C., please welcome the Junkyard Band.
Look around. Is it grooving? Huh? Huh? Is it really grooving? Y'all think so? Let's do some more rock. Want to move to the side one time, all right? Move to the side one time. Now I'm gonna show you the man that carries the heartbeat.
All right. From Washington, D.C., let's have a big round of applause for the Junkyard Band. We certainly don't have anything like that here in the U.S.
Y'all ready to get back with it now? You ready, New York, Manhattan? Let's go, Junkyard Band.
It's now 1987, and myself, Mo Shorter, took over management of the band. We were having a good run, having fun, playing gigs, going all around. Then, guys told me one day, hey Mo, we want to step it up, man. Let's make this thing for real. Let's move to some real equipment. So this happened in 1990. We moved from the buckets, the cans, to the real thing.
Introducing those thumping young troopers from Southeast D.C. Jump! Yo!
The first one, speaking of heavy ones, how was it being at that crossroad? Did y'all feel like that was the end of Junkyard?
I don't know. I can't answer that because it wasn't no crossroad for the band. You know what I'm saying? It just was a dent. I mean, a hell of a crater dent. Like a meteor just hit the earth. Put a serious dent. You know what I'm saying? I was incarcerated at the time. And so I couldn't really get the whole bow of where everything would happen. I had to go from hearsay to hearsay, telling me information was going on. But Bake can more elaborate on that about Heavy One.
Yeah, so I remember when they were shooting, before they even said it, I thought Bill, the comedian, my man, was hanging tight. He called me and he was telling me a little story, what I felt he was saying. Will was dying. I mean, Will got killed, but he ain't really said. All I just had a feeling. Then once I got close to home, shit, they say he died. At the time, I say, damn, I'ma quit. But I ain't never quit. You know, I
okay.
At that time, man, I felt like that.
Right.
Then, you know, overcame it a little bit as a couple of days go past.
Of course.
And kept on pushing on through. So, you know, that's what I had.
Yeah.
When it first happened. But.
We were also, I'm sorry, you finished? Okay. Talking about transitioning from the buckets to the instruments. Speaking of transitions, what's going on with ASJ?
Nothing. It's just sitting on the shelf right now in build up. But if you need that ASJ style to come, it's ready. It's already ready to roll. You want to hit grown and sexy, we can do all that. But we a raunchy band for real.
We just did an ASJ show October 28th. Look out for that CD in the stores now. Down Jimmy's Lounge.
Okay, Jimmy's Lounge still pumping?
Look.
Yeah. I got one other thing to say before you say that, young. It's another generation of Junk. Changing with time, from House and Youngin, James and Dog. So that's, you know,
what
that's
what I pointed to. Y'all about to do the bounce beat?
Huh?
The bounce beat?
Nah, just another generation with the guitars and stuff. You know, making it new, you know, compared to back in the day.
Different flavor.
Okay.
Different flavor. That's why I pointed to them when you said ASJ style. Right. So that's when, you know, that generation came. But it's all gravy. You're just.
I'm here.
Oh, okay. I didn't think I heard that.
This Big Youngin. Y'all just took me through a whole lot of history. Some of these points that I didn't even know And I'm a huge Junkyard fan, but I remember, you know, not to go backwards, but I remember my first, since we were talking about Heavy One, which is the reason why I even started playing drums. It was in about 86, and around Paradise. Everybody know Paradise Mayfair.
Right.
It was an anti-drug rally. And it was a side-by-side band, Junkyard.
I remember that, joint.
And they played, and I was so taken away by them playing just on buckets. Soon as they left, every youngin' in Paradise was going through the woods trying to find buckets and whatever they could find, big trash cans and everything. And ever since then, man, it's just I never looked back as far as drums. When they asked me what I want to play in junior high school, I was like, I don't play drums. I want to play drums.
Okay.
That was my first experience ever seeing Junkyard. I heard a couple of little tapes that I wasn't supposed to have before then.
Right.
But when you see them live, it was just like,
another story.
Yeah, it's a whole other ball game.
Yeah, and that's really interesting when you mentioned the Junks, and I thought it was a real good idea, and everybody picked up on it how y'all pulled them out for the awards program. You know, was that your idea, Wink? You and Baby.
Me and Baby. Me and Baby.
All right.
Sir.
It's a little history with Black Pooh doing the Buckets and Cans.
Yeah.
He had a go-go band too, right? Buckets and Cans competition with Junkies. Let's talk about that a little bit, Black Pooh.
Yes, sir. Top secret in them.
Go out there, Black Pooh.
I'm with J-Y, baby. I don't do no backing up, dog. I'm with J-Y.
Talk about the history about
I play with your man Black
Boo. Legends in the in
play with that Black Boo. I play with your man Black
Boo.
Yeah, yeah. I play with Black Boo, man. We about four bands in the falls, yo. Now four Junk came. You know what I'm saying? This is before Junk. It was like three different bands in one neighborhood. So we had to decide where this one band was gonna come from.
Because
recreation director, Mr. Beffer, kept getting tired of hearing all these bands playing and everybody trying to get to that picnic area for the highlight. That's what we do, our big shows at our competition. We go to the picnic area and get it in, you know what I'm saying? But look, this was happening though. Heavy One bad beat everybody bad, right? Man, Bugs stopped beating everybody up, taking their shit. I started throwing bottles at everybody. Bugs just started roughing everything, took everybody equipment. And we started our whole band all over again with everybody else equipment. We couldn't play everything, so we went and got all the best members out of all them bands. Mr. Bethel put everything together, and then Big Dirk, along with Big Dirk, and then you had Junkyard.
Junkyard.
And look, Junkyard is probably one of the only bands left. One of the only bands left that's known to keep that stage, that dance, and that choreography, and they just putting a state, keeping it. Put it this way, when I heard that y'all was playing at the awards, me myself got psyched because I said, okay, now I know I'm gonna see a show. I'm not gonna just hear it. I'm gonna be able to visually see it, you know. So, I want to ask y'all, since y'all are known for that, how important, or let it know just how important it is for your other stage show.
You're not a band if you ain't got no showmanship with you. Don't nobody just want to come just look at you. You gotta give these people something to look at.
Mm-hmm.
You gotta entertain these people. If you're gonna be a band on a big old stage, you just stand there, you can hear music from the radio.
Right, right.
Yeah, the show, they want to see something they can go home and talk about.
Yeah, listen, We always give us something to talk about. When you want to put us on a big stage, see, and then we going to just sit there and just give you some music and play some little pockets. Nah, we going to give you all that, but this other part right here go with this right here. So you going to see all that show stuff. Mm-hmm. You might get somebody flipping over something, whatever, like KC in the bunny joint. Right on top of it.
Yeah, that's where the inspiration came from Superior Funk back in the days, you know what I'm saying? Imperial Band, Superior Funk, that's where Junk inspired us to come in the band. KC, Dre Dog, Chink from Murder Inc., you know what I'm saying? Black Flag Records. That's what we inspired from. You know what I'm saying? Watching them doing the steps and the buckets and the cans up Congress Heights, you know what I'm saying? And I think that's where we was discovered at. Savoy Elementary School. Yeah. It was Wink. I think it was Wink, Bait, Heavy One, Black Bugs, and I think it was Bruce Belly.
Yeah, it was Bruce.
That acknowledged our talent. Me, KC, Dre, you know what I'm saying? At Savoy High School, elementary school. Jesus, right there on Martin Luther King. When y'all came in there, we was blasting off, you know what I'm saying? Superior Funk, we was getting it in. And we pumped it up from there. And Junkyard always had the craft and the energy and the style, the swagger, all that. That's where it came from. You know what I'm saying? That's where I think it came from. You know what I'm saying?
My interpretation too also is, well, my inspiration from Junk also came from when I was in school, when I used to see Bugs, Bruce Pratt come up to school when they already graduated. I was coming up in my days up Blue with the male course. And after school, when we used to do everything as far as out going to classes and everything, we used to meet up in the music room. And I used to see them pop through the door. And I used to think I'm about ready to go home because I'm tired from being in all them classes. I see them popping the door. They come through the door ready to sing. And at the same time, we all gathered up in our line to sing and sing the songs that our music director got lined up. And we used to go through lists of all that. I'm like, well, I ain't going home no time soon. So we ended up staying at like 5:36. And then that was how I was driven to the band from that.
Now, with so much experience and being in the game for so long, you're going to influence a lot of bands. But when it crossed the line of a band actually taking something that's Junkyard, how do y'all feel about that? Sometimes they say, you know, the best form of flattery is taking somebody's shit. But how do y'all feel about that? Because this band is taking some of y'all's
stuff. I be heated, dog. I mean, want to fight.
I look at it like
this. Northeast right now stole our tonight.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That came from us, man.
Play the game.
Tonight. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? That's Ben and Rose finest all day long. They ain't come from no Northeast. What?
Yeah, that come from Southside. Period. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, this black poop, man. I just got a comment on that, dog. I'm just saying like this, man.
What?
Basically. Everything we do, man, we know somebody gonna like it. We don't know how many people, we don't know who the people gonna be, but we respect it, cause it's like this, you know, if we don't put it out and somebody else put it out, they know where they got it from. You know what I'm saying? I'm like this, dog. The more you take, the better we get. You know what I'm saying? I ain't going with somebody to it,
cause everybody takes from everybody. If you got it here, and you talking about macaroni and cheese, dog, and that's what's happening, everybody gonna be eating macaroni and cheese.
Well, for real, we the teachers. And
yeah.
If they still gotta learn, make me feel good. That's as long as we got. But for real, what we have to do is have these zones on that studio. And they can copy all they want, man. Like tonight, we had to record it. They can copy all they want because this is
CD.
The same thing, like us and R.E., we came out with the same record. Uh-oh.
Same time, man. They came out like a week before we did. You know what I'm saying?
Transition.
Right, but wouldn't that be considered more break minds think alike?
Right, right.
As opposed to if y'all did something.
Then you talking about you talking about the rappers don't do nothing but the same thing. They flip and loop each other's records, man.
No. I'm talking about you and R.E. doing. Oh, that's almost like two rappers sampling between the sheets.
Right, that's what I'm saying. It's,
but if a rapper did between the sheets and then 6 months later another rapper bit that, that's to me it's something different.
All right, let me ask you a question.
Okay. In January and then in July, somebody just snatched that from you.
Okay, our thing is, when you do a record from a rapper or R&B artist, it's called cover tunes. That means the Go-Go bands don't get no respect as far as being real artists, because that's what they say. They're not real artists. They playground artists because they do too many cover tunes. When you got the Go-Go bands doing originals, if we play the original hits that locally that's being played as far as in these venues, as far as the Go-Go bands, you know what I'm saying? We're not scared to respect each other and play each other's music instead of playing some rappers' music or some R&B singers' music, play the music that the Go-Go circuit put out here. You know what I'm saying? Chuck Brown, Proper Utensils, for instance. They never were scared to play a hit made by a Go-Go band. Folks showed you how to make it professional, you know what I'm saying? By being able to say, okay, I'm going to play a Chuck Brown tune on my show. Towards saying, I'm going to play Jay-Z new record. You understand what I'm saying? See, we don't put enough back and emphasis on what we do and put too many emphasis and back on somebody else's project and wonder why they millionaires and we still sitting in the ghetto. You know what I'm saying? So ain't no thing about taking no music. Take the music that belongs to us. As long as our people taking it locally, that's all we worry about, man.
I still like the plurality,
John. That's right. Put your one leg up. Well, yes, sir.
We look at him. Big up, man. Big up, man. One love. Yeah.
Hits, I hear you now.
Yeah. Class band. Spectre Gadget.
We don't steal, like we that. Chill.
You know what I'm saying?
Slaves of the Rhythm by East Oak.
EU.
That's right. East Oak.
That's right.
All right. Going in now. Now, we talking now. We talking, I guess, right now, there's another transition. As we see it happening before our eyes within Go-Go. And I like to ask, and that transition basically is what they're calling the bounce beat, right? Now, I like to see what that transitioning going on, and you have what's been going on the past couple of years or so, is the grown and sexy. Where does Junkyard fit in between the bounce beat, the grown and sexy? You know, have y'all figured that part out? We don't. We got our own crane. Okay. We jump. Okay.
Also, before we go any further, we want to dedicate this night to my cousin. He'll be home real soon. Footloose Wild. No one of them that wrote y'all. Love you, Footloose.
This BY.
We real.
I think that's part of the attention the Junk is getting now is the fact that they not. I mean, we just do Junk, man. First of all, let me give you my opinion on the bounce beat. I'm not taking anything away from it.
because you know a lot of people had criticism when they started opening the hi-hat and go-go.
Right.
It was like, that's not go-go. And I know I heard personally from a lot of old head go-go band members, old head drummers, that ain't real go-go, that ain't this, that ain't that, even the stuff that we play.
Right.
So I'm not taking that away from them. The only thing that I think was lost in the creation of this, or I guess how go-go was transitioning, is the history. Like, they don't, it's just one, like, to me it sounds like, and I might be wrong, but I listen to it and I'm real light on it. Like, I'm not heavy, I'm not real heavy critic, but everybody's doing the same thing. It's like, you got TCB, who pretty much set the trend, where it was inspired by Backyard.
Right,
but
right.
I'm gonna say the TCB took it and made it. Right. They took it to another level.
They took it to that transition.
They took a couple of grooves Backyard played like that, and made
that
their whole performance like that.
Okay.
Yeah, it's almost like I represent to crunk and hip hop.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like crunk go go. And the only thing is, like, everything, like, me personally, and not taking anything from crunk hip-hop artists, is everybody sounding the same. Like, you can put Walking Out to trap music to all that to just go together to me. Because it's not, I mean, me personally, I don't see anybody really being creative and hopping out there except for, like, Outkast. And they not really crunk, but in the South, I don't see a lot of people doing stuff different. So, as far as the crunk, as far as the bounce beat, it's just, to me, beyond the bands who originally started doing it, it's like everybody else, just all the other three-letter bands just falling in place and everybody sound the same.
Okay. Jump is jump. You can't take that from it. We stand out. We different. We not like no other band. It's jump. Straight up. That's T Bizzle.
That sounds like a new groove, y'all.
Holla back.
New song.
And not to take up all the time, but you say also about Grown and Sexy.
Yeah.
Me, even when we did ASJ, and like I don't even put ASJ in that particular category only because we still want you to party. And this is one thing that I think is missing in a lot of the Grown and Sexy shows, is the party. Like me, I know, I guess when I get old enough to where people be like, he a serious old head, if I go pay my money to see Go-Go, it got a crank. I don't care who's up there. I don't care how old the people up there playing it. It got a crank to me.
Right.
So a lot of the Grown and Sexy, they done turned it to Sexy and Standing Still. And you know, yeah, I go see some of them just because it's nice looking ladies there, but beyond that, I mean, a nice little pocket here and there, but beyond that, I can't see myself paying for it.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
Okay. Buy a sandwich.
All right, now the big man said we gotta wrap it up, so need
a pill.
You got one more question? You don't have no more questions? All right, right quick, well, before we wrap it up, just let it be known where Junk can be found playing at every week. Any upcoming stuff like that? Miss Yvette?
Play every Friday. Junkyard play every Friday at the Market Lounge. Look for us coming up at the CFB pretty soon.
Right.
And a possible big show coming up in December.
What's the big show?
Possible show with Chuck Brown at the 9:30 Club.
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay. I'm getting my ticket now.
Where the players be?
What's the
ticket? Yes, sir. Go ahead. One more.
One more question.
Nation.
Each show is supposed to be Junkyard and Publicity. Look for that coming up.
That's a good call. Junkyard at the Nation.
CFP.
All
right. What's in store for
Junkyard
for 2007?
What's in store? What's coming?
Store?
What do Junkyard got planned for us?
Keep your ears open.
A record in the store.
Keep your ears and your eyes.
They all go together. You say what's in store? A record in store.
Don't sleep with
us. That's it.
Too.
That's all.
See,
and some more awards. us, man. Right. We taking this thing real serious.
Go sleep.
We want best singer
coming out,
best artist. We want everything. So we challenging all the go-go bands to get out here and stick together and I make it happen,
that.
Man.
I love that.
Love you too, man.
Don't sleep on us too. True coming that. Out True 2007.
That. Hey, appreciate it, Junk. Appreciate it, Junk. Yep. For real,
yes, sir. Guys. Don't sleep on us too. The secret. All the back, Rabina.
That's Nena the Bean. We don't know who Rabina
is. Nena the Bean.
Y'all get it on up in here, ladies.